Thank you, everyone, for joining the second in our webinar series on the topics raised in last year's white paper, The Human Capital Catalyst. The webinar today is going to take the format of around 30 to 35 minutes discussion, followed by a Q&A session. You'll be able to raise questions at any time in the functionality. And likewise, if you're having any trouble hearing us or seeing us or with the program itself, then please also raise a question in the chat. So I'm actually genuinely excited to be here today. I've worked myself in a number of functions over the years in recruitment, executive search, leadership development, and now in sales and solutions for RPO and MSP. And throughout that time, I've seen great companies, great initiatives that were really needed in the business that could create a lot of positive change, just fail to launch or take longer to launch. And it's made me realize that change management in projects is so much more than just building the thing. I'm currently working on a project internally within Hays with Alex Fraser. Alex is a change expert, and I think the work that we've been doing together, coupled with a lot of the conversations I've been having with you guys, as a result of the survey and the Human Capital Catalyst report from last year, made me realize it would be a great opportunity to combine that and start to think a bit more about change management in the context of workforce management programs. So, Alex, welcome. Perhaps you'd like to tell us a bit about yourself.
Sure. So, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Alex Fraser, and as Ruth said, I am the group head of change for Hays, which means that effectively I'm responsible for supporting and leading the strategic change initiatives for Hays globally. And it also means that I'm responsible for building change capability within our business and making sure that everyone can do change management. But prior to joining Hays, I've been here for now 2 years. I actually have 20 plus years, we won't go into too many specifics, of management consultancy experience within the Big Four. So within KPMG, within PwC, where I was responsible for leading transformations across a number of different industries, and that could involve all sorts of things like tech change, behavioral change, process change, or even fundamental organizational structural change. So I'm very happy to be here.
No, thank you. Thanks for giving up time in what we both know is a really busy schedule right now. So that leads me to a question, because you know, as someone that also works on the kind of provider consulting side, and you spent so many years working with Big Four companies on that, what made you decide to come in-house, and why come in-house to us? This is 2 years ago now, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So the life of a management consultant is hugely exciting and never short of variety, and you're always doing something new and meeting new clients and doing new projects. But there was always a hole, right? So when you're a management consultant, you go in, you sort out, and then you leave, and you don't necessarily always get to see things through. And I have got to a point where I really wanted to see things through, and I wanted to create a legacy and make sure that the change that I'm embedding actually remains embedded and sustained, and I can really join up that change narrative. And why Hays? Well, actually, Hays was the last project I worked on at KPMG.
You built our methodology.
I did. And I fell in love with the culture, and I fell in love with the passion that Hays has around really wanting to do change properly, understanding the importance of change and wanting to do it properly to make sure that they really embed change and realise the benefits. So it was kind of a win-win, create the legacy, but also be part of a company that really wants to move in that direction.
Thank you. And I am so going to remind you that you've said that and recorded it when we're deep in the depths of trying to cope with some of the challenges that come up in change. So obviously, we want to talk about this in the context of workforce management. But just to start really with the bigger picture, why is organizational change and managing change so important?
So the world around us, whether we like it or not, is continually evolving, and businesses have to evolve in line with that change to make sure that they can continually address customer needs and, as part of that, maintain their competitive edge. Quite frankly, if we stand still, we'll just get run over. Other people will overtake us, and we just won't be here tomorrow. So we have to evolve, we have to adapt. But change isn't simple. It never just happens on its own by miracle. You have to really work hard at it. And you can find that some of the best solutions in the world can be designed. But if your people don't want to adopt it, they fast become worthless. So it's really important not only to go for the change, but to make sure you do it properly. Otherwise, it could be a waste of your investment.
So kind of knowing that it's important and you want to do it is only part of the battle. It's not the whole thing. So perfect opportunity then, I think, for us to introduce our first poll. We do want this to be interactive. So thank you for putting that up. So the first thing we want to get from you is where do you think your organisation is right now in relation to change and change management? Is it something that just happens to you? Is it chaotic? There's a need to do it, but there's no standardised approach. Is there a methodology, but perhaps it's not fully adopted across the entire organisation? Or are you guys just rocking change management and you've got a consistently strong approach methodology and it's all landing very well? We'll wait for those results to come in.
That's really interesting, just looking at those results. And as I'd expected, so I don't think anyone can put their hand on their heart at the moment and say that they have a really, really strong change approach consistently across the board. And change is very rarely welcomed by everyone. But actually, this really highlights a key point that you can have a really good approach, but actually even then just having it isn't enough. It's about understanding how to apply it really effectively. That's really important. And equally, no approach at all can actually be really scary and really increase the amount of stress that you feel when you're going through change. It doesn't have to be that way. It can actually feel like quite a smooth process, but you need to have a consistent approach to it.
Thanks, Alex. I'm going to put the second poll up actually now, and I'm going to put that up and give people a couple of minutes to read it because I appreciate it might be a little bit wordy. So I want you to consider recent change projects, and it could be an MSP or an RPO implementation or a different type of organisational change, but think through that initiative and tell us how it landed. Did it just never happen, disappeared, was buried? Did it happen, but in a very compromised position that stopped it really being able to realise value? Did it launch, but kind of fizzled out and there were no benefits seen? Did it start well and then die off? Or again, did it get there, achieve the objectives and make a positive impact on the business? Again, we'll give it a second to see what the results are.
Great, again. No huge surprise. What we're seeing there is that actually a very small proportion of them achieve the objectives that they set out to do. And if you think about all of the time, money and effort that goes into them, that's quite worrying. And that one around, it seemed to be going in the right direction, but we just didn't see the benefits is just so common. And actually quite a common symptom of somewhere along the line, that change methodology hasn't been fully completed or fully followed through. So not a surprise. And I think, for me, they all highlight the possible impact of not managing change properly. There's a real reason behind why we do it. It's not the fluffy stuff that sometimes people think it is. And I think people are actually gaining a lot more respect for this. It's countless amount of research that has actually shown that projects that implement and actually effectively apply change management are 6 times more likely to meet and exceed their actual objectives, purely because it really helps make sure that people understand what's happening. So there's a less ambiguity and confusion, anxiety in the people that you're trying to actually impact. And as a result, there is less resistance to change. And as a result, people are generally more engaged. And we all know that engaged employees are good employees that will become productive and help us do that. So it actually reduces the impact on employee engagement. It develops a real sense of ownership, which is really important. It's all too easy to have sloping shoulders and say it's someone else's problem. It's someone else's thing. It's not mine. But change management is all about making sure that people all feel some kind of accountability and responsibility. It also means that you can be much more focused in the support. So it's not about one size fits all. It's about knowing your audience, knowing who needs what support so that you can get to the right people at the right time in the right way. So that's really important, particularly if your resources are stretched. So you can't be everywhere all the time, but you need to know where needs it most.
And let's face it, every organisation has stretched resources right now.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's almost universal in everyone we speak to. So you need to be able to use them wisely to get the best out of them. And most importantly, similar situation, Ruth, is that minimises disruption to productivity. You know, you may not only get the benefits of the change, but what you can see is that actually significantly degrades where you were before. Now, no one wants that, but if you don't have change management in there, that is what can happen. So it not only gets worse, but you don't get the benefits as well.
Yeah, of course, of course.
So this was really why back in the days when I was at KPMG that I was approached to support Hays with building a change methodology specifically for Hays. And how much energy that has been put into it right from the top, right from the management board down, in terms of making sure that everyone in the business is aware of this methodology and is always applying it consistently in any change program across Hays. So there's been a huge amount of training and education done over the last 3 to 4 years where we've really embedded this. And ironically, if you go back to that first poll when we said we've got a methodology, but people don't actually consistently embed it, people don't often realise that when you have a change methodology, you actually have to go through a change programme in order to embed the methodology. So it's not enough saying it's there. You have to train people and it has to become part of business as usual, which is often where it goes wrong. So what you can see on screen now is actually our change management methodology that we developed for Hays, or I developed for Hays and now I'm Hays. How confusing. But it's pretty simple in terms of where we're trying to get to with this. A 5-stage approach, which takes you right from the outset, right through to beyond launch. And that's quite important. So the 5 phases, shape, plan, prepare, deliver, and sustain. Shape is something that quite often doesn't get done that well. It's about making sure that people understand where they want to go, have a really clear view of where they want to go and why. Why it's the right thing to do and why it's the right thing to do now. And it's also about being able to measure or state how you'll know you've got there. So you wouldn't go and play golf in the dark, I assume. You wouldn't go and play football without a goal. Everyone needs to know where you're trying to get to and how they'll know that they'll be successful. So this is all about making sure that you've got a really clear direction that you're moving in. Plan is all about making sure that once you know where you want to go, you understand where you are now, and therefore how much of a change is it in reality to go from where you are today to where you want to get to. And that means making it real for people. That's not just about top level fundamental changes. That's about for Joe Bloggs, who sits in his desk on a Monday, what are you going to ask him to do differently on a Tuesday that he didn't have to do on a Monday? So it's actually quite granular. It's actually quite detailed in terms of really understanding in reality what's going to have to change for anyone who is impacted by a project. Through that, you would then understand what support they need in terms of training and communication, and you can build your plans. As you move on to prepare, this is all about making sure that once you have your plans, you're building all the support that people need in order to be able to equip them with the skills and the knowledge and the confidence to really be able to adopt that change. So that's a lot about developing the solution, developing the support, and deliver does what it says on the tin. This is about making sure you're ready to go because everyone's feeling ready, willing, and able, but also all of the solution are in place and you can press go. Now, sustain, the final phase, is one that people love to forget. But it's actually about saying there is something else that happens after you press go. And it's about making sure that you understand whether or not you have got to where you said you wanted to be. And if you have, how are you going to sustain that? And if you haven't, rather than giving up and saying it didn't work, it's about saying, well, what do we need to change? What additional support do we need to give? in order to get to where we want to get to. So a pretty simple, you know, it doesn't look like rocket science, but it really helps to provide a framework to make sure that people don't forget to think about the right things and the right people at the right time.
And I think this is so useful when it comes down to managed service programs, because one of the things we often underestimate when we're implementing an MSP or an RPO is that it's complicated, right? That recruitment and workforce management as a change, implementing a program touches every part of the business. Everybody in the company at one point was recruited, and most of them at some point will need to hire other people, whether permanent or acquiring skills via a temporary contracting or even via a statement of work. So they all need access to skills. And the impact of not having access to skills is business critical. It can impact production, it can impact bottom line, and it can also impact staff well-being. If the right people aren't in place, that puts additional pressure on the resources you've got. So it's an emotional topic as well as a process topic. And that is why I think within MSP, one of the biggest learns and the biggest gains we've made is implementing a change methodology. And it's where I see it certainly chimes with the feedback we received in the Human Capital Catalyst, that it was one of the single biggest reasons for programs not achieving their potential in the first year. You can totally see how failure to put a decent change management plan around your implementation is going to cause just at root level, but some panic and resistance. So let's think about this in the context of the change methodology, and we'll just kind of work through this, some of these stages. We don't have time to do them all in a lot of detail, but we'll work through a couple of them in the context of MSP. If we start with shape, because I think that's, as you said, is one of the most important one. I think one of the biggest challenges we have in shape is understanding the problem that the business is trying to solve, and making sure that both your primary stakeholders, so the people that are using and receiving the service, and your secondary stakeholders, which is usually the central departments of procurement or HR and TA, are aligned in what the problem is that they're trying to solve. Would really like your feedback and your thoughts on that.
So it's a really common problem. And as I said before, you know, if it's really common in a lot of companies that they jump straight to prepare, to be honest. They jump straight to prepare and deliver. They think they know what the solution is, so they just go ahead and do it, and they want to put it in. They don't pay much attention to that early part. And what often happens in that regard is that people start with a solution and then seem to try and find the problem that it addresses. So they go the wrong way around. And they need to, you know, they know they need something, but they really don't understand what the root issue is of the problem. And now the problem with that is that we then end up designing something that doesn't actually address the problem, won't therefore give you the desired impact, and actually will only mean that the problem may reoccur time and time again after that. So it's really, really important that you take some time before you even get into designing your MSP. I know that the appetite and you want to get started, but actually taking some time to really understand all the issues, what are you trying to address, what does that mean for different people, and get your leaders aligned, all of your leaders.
So I think this is really interesting, because generally from when we're talking about managed services, the people that we're talking to in the centre of the business, they recognise that there's an issue. They need visibility, they need to better understand the skills, how they manage and anticipate and prepare for the skills that they need, how they take them on, how much they're spending, what their risk profile is. But the primary stakeholders often don't see a problem. So how do you, because there isn't one, because right now if they need to access resources, they've just got a very simple process to go and access those resources. And the reality is an MSP is going to disrupt that process. So how do you bring on those kind of stakeholders when, as far as they're concerned, there is no problem?
So in part or shape, the key thing is you understand where you want to go, but you have to have a really clear case for change, a really clear rationale. There is a child in all of us that will ask you why, and unless you give me a really good reason, I'm not going to do it. Okay, so what we often do in these cases, and what it sounds like you're referring to there, is we build a case for change that actually is only relevant to some of the stakeholders. So we don't make it relevant, we don't talk about what's in it for me, for those primary stakeholders who, you know, are saying, well, actually, it's not broken, so why are you trying to fix it? People will only change if they feel a level of dissatisfaction with how they are currently working, and they can see that your vision for the future and your intention or your first steps towards making that vision happen are genuinely better than the pain that they will have to go through in achieving that change. So, you know, we actually go through that in our minds when we're trying to change. And it really is important to build a really compelling reason that speaks to people in their language to say, look, I appreciate it's not broken, but just think about how much easier it would be and how much better it would be if we had X, Y, or Z. And it can take time. And you have to listen, and you have to listen to their objections and listen to why they're saying no, to really understand what motivates them. Once you understand what motivates them, you can then turn that into a benefit for them, explain it into their terms, and really win their hearts and minds through that.
So I think that's really interesting. I just want to check, do we have a slide on that with the problem statement versus vision? Thank you very much. So I think this is really interesting because we can't. So first of all, in an ideal world, you would be coming to solve a problem. But we know that in the case of the primary stakeholders in MSP, there is no problem. And the vision of the future isn't there yet. And you can't build that vision for people. They've got to build it themselves. So, but it doesn't need to be like a massive light bulb moment. All you need to do is move by working with them and by going into the detail of how their current working operations are, find current areas of dissatisfaction, because there will be once people step back and start to think about it, talk to them about what good would look like and what a future vision could look like, and you just need to move the dial on those areas a bit. You don't need to have a transformational adjustment there, and that will start to help bring them on the road to improvement. And I recognize that now in the programs that the project that we're working on, when I think back to the start, even just a few months ago, where we were thinking, okay, there are some people here who I'm not sure there's going to be a benefit for them, and actually by working through this with them, we all start to see that there will be. But it does bring me on to a second point, actually, which is we do sometimes in our programs see key stakeholders being brought in too late. I've got a fantastic, actually it wasn't fantastic, it was awful, experience of a kickoff meeting that was supposed to be a kickoff meeting for us as part of a consortium of providers. And the stakeholders that had been invited to the kickoff meeting, it was very quickly apparent to us that this was the first time they were hearing even about the concept of what we were there to put in place. And as you can imagine, it's the whole thing set the whole project back by quite a while, because they were way, way back on where they needed to be on the change curve. Talk to me a bit about that.
I think you hit the nail on the head earlier when you said change is an emotional thing, and people feel quite emotional about the degree to which they need to be involved. They need to be consulted if you're going to do something that's going to impact their world. Now, it's really critical if you want change to be successful for any leaders who are going to be directly impacted themselves, or who have teams who are going to be impacted, that they are involved right from the beginning, so that they feel like they're being involved in shaping that solution, because that really helps to build ownership and accountability. And once they feel that it's kind of like their idea, that they've been involved, they automatically feel more responsible for making it a success. So it needs to be both sides of a fence. From an MSP perspective, all sides need to feel like they've got some skin in the game. They need to feel like they need to contribute, and they need to drive adoption. They need to be involved in that.
And it really is all stakeholders, isn't it?
Absolutely, all stakeholders.
So that's going to be affected.
Yeah. It's going to be procurement, but it's also going to be HR. It could be legal. It's going to be IT. It's going to be operations. It's going to be HR. All of them need to have a stake. And it's really important to understand and involve them early on, because if they're not involved until later on, they'll think that they're an afterthought. Yeah. If they're not involved at all, then the chances are that they're just going to say, no, that was your game, mine. I never agreed to it. So it's really important that you get it from the beginning. It's also really important to make sure that that's the beginning of really building a change army. No one can do change alone. So, Ruth, you know, from the project we're working on, I might sit in, of course, some of the plans, But I couldn't do it alone. I can't cover 34 countries globally and talk to every individual stakeholder. So I have to build a change army. And that's really important to think about this as well. It's important to have feet on the ground, people on the ground who can help you bring other people on, because acceptance breeds acceptance, excitement breeds excitement. So you need a group of peers, a group of different people at different levels who can do that. It's really important to make sure that you have the right people. I often see the mistake that people use people who are free. You seem to have a bit of free time. One, there's usually a reason they've got a bit of free time. And two, you know, they're probably not the right people for the job. You need people who've got a great network. You need people who have the right people skills. You need people who are going to be objective and challenge you as a team and, you know, challenge you if you say something that they don't think is going to work, but equally be supportive when they need to be and help you drive it through the business. So the one thing I said would say is, build the right change army, but build it with the right people so that you really have a positive and strong coalition behind you to help you drive it through.
Brilliant. Thank you. Right, I'm going to move as quickly through some of these other stages because I've got an eye on the clock. So if we go into plan, here's my observation of what we see most often in MSP implementation in planning is that there is a focus really only on the tools and occasionally on the processes that sit behind them, but not enough on the behaviours and actually what the actual outcomes are that we're looking to change.
So what to do? So
give me your perspective.
What's really common is that people forget that actually people have to use the systems, and therefore a system or a tool can only enable a change. It can't actually drive a change. And it will only ever be as good as the people who are using those tools. They can't operate in a vacuum. So it's really important to spend time in plan, thinking and exploring genuinely what happens, how people work today. So that's not go back and have a look at your training plans and how you taught people how to do things, but that's genuinely getting down on the ground, getting down on that shop floor and finding out what happens today. How does this process actually work? And not from managers, but from people who actually do the job. Only then, once you know what's happening now and you can understand the pain points, the duplications of effort, should you look at how they need to work at the future and think about what basics do I actually need to fix? So rather than put in a solution and think it's going to solve all your problems, you may well find that there are some other things that need to get tightened up and made more efficient so that you're actually building on a solid foundation. Otherwise, quite frankly, your solution may not be fit for purpose and you're not likely to see any benefit. I think it's really important to remember it's usually got something to do with behaviours, it's usually got something to do with culture, and it's usually got something to do with behaviours and processes. So, you know, people
and it,
are
and it's important to get into the right into the detail, isn't it, as well? I guess I'm thinking back to an example of where we launched a program with a VMS, and it was only afterwards we couldn't figure out why it wasn't landing at all in one department. And then we went and spoke to a particular stakeholder group, which was the admin stakeholder group, and we discovered that whilst there had been processes in place before, this stakeholder group had been doing manual workarounds of something that was an already broken process for years. They hadn't been consulted. We hadn't caught that. And annoyingly, there was a fantastic problem there waiting to be solved, but just we uncovered it 9 months too late. And by then, that required a little bit of unworking. And that was a really interesting learn for us.
I think it can feel like that it's going to take a lot of time, but I can guarantee you having that understanding will prevent exactly that. So actually, it's really worth in shape and shape and plan, taking your time before you dive in, because actually that time that you invest up front will far outweigh, you know, going quickly and then having to mop up at the end.
Fantastic. Thank you. So let's move into prepare and deliver. Sure. We'll cover those two together. I mean, this is the point where you're executing, right? So this is often quite challenging. And that's at the point where all the roadblocks that you think you prepared for and uncovered and avoided will all start to pop up at a point when you're under a time pressure. And this is where compromise can set in. What's your thoughts on that? How could you advise us to avoid that in our programs?
So what often happens is once people, if they have done shape and plan, even if they've done that bit and they've been consulting with people, they tend to disappear back off into their little black hole after that and go and develop their solutions. They've done their listening bit. Everyone's fine. So I'm just going to do what I said I'd do and then I'll show you the end product. It's really important that that doesn't happen. It's a consistent, iterative process of talking and communicating with people, listening to what they're saying. So when someone puts down a requirement in plan, it's not until they see it come to life that they think, oh, hang on a minute, that wasn't quite what I wanted, that wasn't quite what I need. Yep. But if you wait till the end, it's quite hard to go back. So it's really important that there's a really strong and, you know, clear rhythm with which and communication with which you'll go back to your stakeholders throughout prepare, throughout deliver, so that you're always talking and listening to them and understanding if you're still on the right track. It's also important to make a commitment to yourself to say, you know, I need to not compromise, but I need to be agile. So I need to be prepared to listen. And if someone comes up with a really good reason or a really good suggestion, I have to be prepared to take that on. And I think that's where you have to be really, really clear right from the offset of what are your must-haves? What are your nice-to-haves? You know, so that you don't get pushed over those boundaries that you talked about in terms of actually I've ended up with something that I'm not very happy with. But right at the beginning with those key stakeholders, you have to set your parameters of the that's a non-negotiable, that's a nice to have, and be really, really clear on that. And I think it's just really important in both of these phases that you don't just think the job is done and you don't just have to send out an email, because that rattles me greatly. You have to talk, you have to listen, you have to create a feedback.
And you've got to take the feedback on board.
You've got to be prepared to do that. It'd be scary, but you've got to do it, because that will make your project so much stronger. If they don't think you're listening, that will damage their trust in you, and that will therefore damage their engagement in the program.
Thank you. So helpful. And you know what, the annoying thing is, there's so much more that we've talked about, but we don't have 3 hours and we wouldn't be able to maintain a captive audience for that time. So with that, I'm going to move into sustain, because out of all five, this is probably one of the most important, and this is one of the ones that probably creates threes and fours where there should be fives. And if you think back to that previous poll that we did, so we kind of press go. Any project, there's going to be a period of hypercare or support, and then we just assume that not only is the system in place, the process is in place, but that the habits are in place as well.
Yeah, and that's not the case. That's not the case. Change just doesn't happen overnight. Humans need to have time for that to embed. I think they say something like, you know, even bare bones, a habit takes something like 7 weeks to form, or, you know, 21 consecutive full-on days of doing it. So it's not just going to happen. People need time, they need constant reinforcement, and we're all too quick to move on to the next shiny thing. And it is really important that we plan sustain really carefully, and we've got that reinforcement all the way through. We have to remember that for the majority of people who are actually joining the project to deliver, they don't know much about it. They haven't been on the same journey as everyone who's been involved in the project all the way through. So this is them getting used to it. If you've been involved in the program, you've had months to get used to the idea, and they're being asked to get on board with the idea, start using it, start doing it all in the space of a week. And that's just not tenable. You've just turned their routine upside down, and their routine is what makes them feel confident and able to do their job. It's their drumbeat, as you will, that makes them feel they're in a comfort zone. So when you throw their drumbeat out of sync, they feel out of control. They feel like they haven't got the confidence. So in order to embed that change properly, you have to go through quite a structured way of thinking, how can I rebuild that drumbeat so it feels like it's normal? It feels like this is what happens. This is just how everyone works around here.
So I'm going to check a challenge in there, because in MSP, one of the challenges we have in particular is that not all users are using the solution from day one. So you'll have some hiring managers that will be using the VMS and the MSP process regularly, weekly. Some of them may only do it once or twice a year. So how do you make sure you change their drumbeat as well?
So you absolutely have to know your stakeholders, and you absolutely have to know when they're likely to come on board and what support they're likely to need. So obviously you'll have those that you'll train maybe all at the beginning, But if they're not going to use it right at the beginning, then the chances are that you probably shouldn't train them until they need to use it,
yes.
because that learning will be dead. So it's a useless use of their time. And it's also, you know, difficult for you because you think they know it and they won't. So it's about making sure you're knowing your stakeholders, training them at the right side, making time, making sure that there are resources available to help refresh people's memory. So, you know, for instance, at the moment, a lot of the work we're doing, Ruth, that you'll recognise is using digital adoption platforms so that we've always got in-app guidance built in so that even if people haven't used it for a while, they can generally go through really easy workflows to work out what they should be doing. It's also about knowing your early adopters. Again, come back to building your army. You don't have to do all of that work, but what you do have to do is make sure that you've got people carefully placed around the business who will become your early adopters and therefore your ambassadors, and who can share their good news stories and their success. And through that, other people will be able to turn to them, ask them, as well as you. So I think it's about recognizing that, not worrying about it, but making sure that the support is right, is available at the right times.
Thank you. So listen, before we sum up, because I'm just watching the clock keep ticking, and I want one final poll out to everybody, just to check people are still there and still awake. The final question is, in your opinion, what do you think your business most needs in order to improve change management effectiveness, particularly in workforce management? We'll give that a minute for those answers to pop in. Okay, thank you. More time and focus and having the right resources.
I'd agree with that.
And the record, yeah. Yeah, agreed. So, Alex, we just to finalise, tell me what, if there's a nutshell, what do you think the key points are that people should take away from today?
So, know your stakeholders. And make sure you're including the right people from the beginning and throughout, making sure that they really sit at the heart of all the decisions and change you make. Understand that it's never really usually about just putting in a tool and it'll all be fine if we have the right tool. Not just papering over the cracks, because you need that strong foundation to really be able to build on. And making sure that, or remembering that for many, the change starts at go live. So making sure that you've really got a plan as to how you're going to constantly reinforce that and help people to attain those targets and make meaningful targets as well. That's one thing I would say. Make sure that those targets are something they can all relate to. Above all, just keep talking, keep listening, and embrace feedback. It can be difficult, but believe me, you'll get a better result in the end.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Alex, for all of that. So we've had some questions coming in while we've been talking, and I'm going to leave the questions window open here just on my right, so that if there's any more that want to come in, then I can add them. But I am going to ask a couple now, because I think we've still got a few more minutes. The first one actually is around your last point around targets and objectives. So this is the question says is we often set an objective for our MSP in the launch, but we don't set objectives across our own business. Should we be doing that?
Absolutely is the answer. So it comes back to, if you think about the point we made in SHAPE around having a case for change that is relevant to people, that overall objective is only going to be attained if everyone plays their part. And that means that everyone adopts the solution properly. So in order to get to that overall objective, you need to break that down into meaningful objectives for different stakeholder groups. So it'll be an entirely different one, say, for your operations guys to your guys in procurement. But they'll all add up. Everyone plays a role. And if you can break down the targets so they're meaningful and relevant to each group, it makes it much easier for them to understand what they need to do.
And I guess measure the success for any final people who are still resistant to the change. You've got then a consensus that says this is what it was meant to achieve and it's achieved. Excellent. Thank you. Next question is, so of all those five phases that you've discussed,
Yeah.
Which one do you think is the most difficult to get right and why? Which is your favourite, Alex?
Which is, I think I've sort of alluded to this. I think shape is probably the hardest because it's where you really have to put energy into focusing on the right thing, involving the right people and getting to some conclusions, which means that you can start off on the right tracks. Often, obviously, at the beginning of a project, lots of people are coming in with lots of different perspectives and you have to balance it and find out where the right line is between all of it to make sure that you have something that everyone is happy to go along with. So I think the hardest one and the one that's done most poorly is actually the one from the beginning, because I think that sets the tone for how the rest of the project will go. If that's successful, you should be all right. If it's not, then you might have a problem. But equally, sustain is hard because you have to fight that temptation for people to just want to move on to the next thing.
Yeah, of course. And there's also all these competing priorities that have been hitting all of our inboxes while we've been doing it. Excellent. Okay. So one final question. Actually, I think this is probably one that I might need to answer, which is that contingent labour change is typically handled by procurement. What role do you think HR could play in this? And how do we convince them to play a part if it's not in their remit? So, I mean, I think increasingly that's becoming less the case. I think increasingly what we're seeing across businesses is that contingent workforce management is just forming a general talent agenda that's owned by HR and TA. We've seen a couple of recent programs where actually HR have been in the lead for implementation and for the change management element with procurement as one of the internal stakeholders. I'm sure there's procurement people that might quite welcome that because it might mean a little bit less to do. But the more people, the better, I think, involved in this. Alex, I don't know if anything else to add.
I don't think you have to. I think when any one function feels they have to take the lead, that honestly becomes a bit of a problem. It needs to be seen as a joint venture that they can all contribute in, and actually having a sponsor from each one of the functions is usually pretty helpful. So someone who's been actually assigned the accountability for saying, I'm going to look at it from my perspective and add in my perspective from there. HR is always going to be important, and actually I think it plays a part because there may well be skills, additional skills or different ways of doing things that need to come into this that sometimes get forgotten. So we don't train people up in those new skills and that new knowledge. And actually that's where it falls down. So I actually think HR and all of the sub-functions within HR often play a really important part. And we can't just turn up at the last minute and say, right, we need you to do this. You need to involve them from the beginning.
No, I agreed completely. And I think also having an operational stakeholder up there in the lead is what makes the difference, because it's there. They are the owner of the primary stakeholders. And there's a whole chapter on the white paper that talks about primary and secondary stakeholders, which would be a great follow on for this. So listen, thank you, Alex. There's still a couple of questions coming in. For everyone who's here, if we haven't managed to answer your questions now, we will still commit to reviewing them and sending you an answer after this webinar. And thank you everyone for joining us. The webinar's available as a recording. We'll circulate that after this. Alex, thank you so much for your expertise.
You're welcome.
And for sharing that with us. And to all our attendees, thanks for joining us. I hope you found some useful points to take away that are relevant to MSP. And please follow us on LinkedIn to find out about the next webinar that we'll be running as part of our Human Capital Catalyst series. Thank you everyone, goodbye.